Emilie Cardon is a postdoctoral researcher at the University of Antwerp in Belgium. For her PhD, she explored the neural activity underlying tinnitus perception. We asked her if she was interested in doing a written interview with us, and she agreed. While we realize that her research only focuses on tinnitus, the subject and contents of her research are too interesting not to explore further. Many of our viewers also have tinnitus, and her research might eventually help in finding treatments for hyperacusis. In October of 2022, she competed in the Belgian PhD Cup, finishing second. Congratulations for that, Emilie. Having been a musician, Emilie studied musicology after graduating from high school. During these studies, she became more interested in how the brain interprets music and other sounds around us. So she decided to study neurosciences after graduating. Emilie and her research group were interested in trying to objectify tinnitus research. One of the many challenging aspects of tinnitus research is that researchers are so reliant on all kinds of subjective measures, like asking someone whether they have tinnitus or what their tinnitus sounds like, sending patient questionnaires, etc. But those subjective measures are not ideal for research purposes. They might not be sensitive enough to pick up changes after a certain treatment, and they are also often quite difficult for people with tinnitus. For example, it's not easy to say how intrusive your tinnitus has been on average during the last 4 weeks. Their goal was to develop a model that was able to use a large amount of data to classify people with tinnitus and people without tinnitus. Emilie and her colleagues recorded the brain's activity while people were listening to certain sounds. They used EEG, which is a method of recording the brain's electrical activity, like they use for sleep research. Participants placed a cap containing about 30 electrodes on their heads, then were given headphones through which they heard certain sounds. The participants heard two different tones. One was normal, which occurred 80% of the time, and the other was a higher tone which played 20% of the time. People were asked to pay attention to this tone specifically, and every time they heard it, they had to press a button. The fact that people have to pay attention to that one specific sound elicits a very specific reaction in the brain at around 0.3 seconds after people hear the sound. The more one is capable of paying attention to that sound, or for instance, the more unexpected that sound is, the larger that response will be. They found that if you have tinnitus, the brain's response to that important sound is diminished. Specifically, Emilie and colleagues observed that some important brain areas, both auditory and non-auditory, did not respond as well to those sounds in people with tinnitus. The most notable brain areas observed were the bilateral temporal cortex, insula, and parahippocampus. They believe this is the case because those brain areas are already so preoccupied with tinnitus, they don't have enough resources to also deal adequately with those external sounds. The difference between people with and without tinnitus was so vast that they could accurately classify a new set of data. They could objectively determine who had tinnitus and who didn't. There's a lot of earlier research that used this exact same method to compare people with versus without tinnitus, but not to detect tinnitus. One of the first things that Emilie did in her research was to compile all of those earlier papers in a meta-analysis. Based on the meta-analysis, they already suspected that specific brain response was diminished if one had tinnitus, but they couldn't know for sure, because a lot of earlier papers did not accurately correct for important factors that could have an effect on those kinds of findings. There are many things researchers have to take into account, such as hearing levels, age, anxiety levels, depression, and so on. What makes Emilie's study unique is that they attempted to match each person in the tinnitus group with their match in the non-tinnitus group, like a sort of dating agency. That way, they could be sure that any differences they found could be specifically attributed to tinnitus and not to any of those other factors. The idea to detect tinnitus actually came from machine learning practices. Developing a model that is able to detect the presence of tinnitus in new data is much more powerful than just comparing two groups. Despite being able to detect tinnitus in the brain, this does not necessarily mean that it originates in the brain, or at least not for everyone. There is a strong link between hearing loss and tinnitus, but some people develop tinnitus without having any kind of measurable hearing loss. So there must be other factors at play. Emily believes that the original cause of tinnitus might very well be hearing loss that might be permanent or transient, but may also be other bodily problems, like jaw or neck complaints, or psychological issues, but that regardless of the cause, they see a pattern of brain activity that explains why tinnitus then becomes a problem and has an impact on daily life. For instance, they see altered activity in many regions that are important for the regulation of attention, which might explain why for some people it is so difficult to direct their attention away from the tinnitus. They also see altered activity and connectivity in regions that process emotions, which is possibly why in some people, tinnitus comes with an elevated emotional burden. Compared to hyperacusis, there is more funding available for tinnitus research because it is more well known. A tricky part of applying for research grants for tinnitus is that no one really seems to agree on how to categorize tinnitus. Emily and her colleagues always submit their projects in the neuroscience category, but then they must compete with very important research, such as neurodegenerative disorders. However, tinnitus doesn't really seem to fit within the traditional ear, nose, and throat categories either, because of its strong influence on the brain. At this moment, they are only looking at cortical auditory evoked potentials, CAEP, so only responses at the cortical level. There's some evidence of alterations at the brainstem level, BAEP, but based on the literature, it's really hard to differentiate between effects of tinnitus and the effects of high-frequency hearing loss. Middle latency potentials, MLAEP, are almost never investigated in this population. Emily notes, it's interesting that as their research field is progressing, they're seeing similar areas pop up in both EEG and fMRI studies. Both anterior and posterior cingulate gyrus seems to be heavily implied in tinnitus. There are likely different networks that are important for different aspects of tinnitus. For example, Emily and her colleagues focus quite heavily on the salience network in their paper, but you can also find evidence for a tinnitus distress network, attention network, and so on. Emily is not able to say that one region is the cause of the perception of tinnitus, at least not right now, but says it would be interesting to see how the neuromodulation of those different areas might potentially impact the tinnitus itself. There is so much to do in the research field. It might also be very individualized, which would give researchers more of a starting point for personalized treatment.
Thanks for watching our video. If you like what you saw, hit that like button, subscribe for future content, and share our channel to help spread awareness of this condition. If you have any comments or questions, you can leave them below or contact us at hyperacusiscentral@gmail.com.